Very good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Let's start the program with the invocation.
Shanti nilava vendum, ingum shanti nilava vendum, Atma shakti vonga vendum, ulagile shanti nilava vendum, Atma shakti vonga vendum, ulagile shanti nilava vendum. Gandhi Mahatma kattalaiyadve Gandhi Mahatma kattalaiyadve Karunai votrumai kadiroli paravi Shanti nilava vendum Kodumai seidiyor manamade thirandu Nargunamade pugattiduvom Madamayacham marupom makkalin masila nallozhukkam valarpom Didam tarum ahimsa yoginam tandai Didam tarum ahimsa yoginam tandai Atmanandam perave கடமை மறவோம் அவர் கடன் தீர்ப்போம் கலங்கமில் அறம் வளர்ப்போம் எங்கும் சாந்தி நிலவ வேண்டும் ஆத்மசக்தி ஓங்க வேண்டும் உலகிலே சாந்தி நிலவ வேண்டும் தேங்க்யூ
Thank you. May now request Dr. S. Y. Subramanian, Dean Planning and Development, to deliver the welcome address and introduce the guests to this August gathering.
Distinguished speaker for this morning's session of the Daksh Power Talk series, Sri T.S. Subramanian, faculty colleagues, special invitees, and my dear student friends, Dr. Badri had requested me to introduce the chief guest and also welcome the gathering, but I thought I will do the second part in more measure and the first part in little measure, because a person of Mr. TSR Subramanian's stature needs no introduction to an audience, because I don't think anybody of you can miss him in the television channels every night, because he is the person who is sought after by almost all the TV channels when it comes to talking about issues of very diverse stakes. That is because he has a very distinguished career in the civil services and occupied the highest post in the civil services when he retired as the cabinet secretary. Which means that he brings along with him an aggregate wisdom of heading almost all the departments, controlling the secretaries of all the departments, and also bringing into his intellectual capital the experience of working in various international organizations associated with the UN. And more than that, he is also a very good-natured person in terms of his philanthropic engagements that he pursues. Currently also the Chancellor of the Shivanadar University. And a person who has a very rich educational background, graduate studies from the Calcutta University, went to the Imperial College and also did his master's in public administration from the Kennedy School at Harvard University. And that is why we see today the manifestation of a multidimensional intellect in the physical presence of Mr. T.S.R. Subramanian amidst us this morning. And ladies and gentlemen, please welcome on behalf of on behalf of SASTRA management, faculty and students, and also on behalf of the people of Thanjavur, because he also spent his formative years of schooling in Thanjavur. So ladies and gentlemen, we are very happy. Sir, we are very happy that you are here amidst us for this morning session. And the second part, usually a welcome address, I lay down the context for the topic that lies ahead for us for the next 1 hour or so. You see, the popular adage is strong democratic institutions, democratic countries like ours, we have the three pillars that support the establishment of democracy, namely the legislative, the executive, and the judiciary. And I must confess at the outset that I have never been a politician, so I'm not a participating member of the legislative process, but I'm very actively engaged in political commentary. And also that I have never been a part of the bureaucratic machinery, except that I've been a consumer of a benevolent bureaucracy a few years back, and today really yearning for a bureaucracy which is genuinely benevolent. And thirdly, I am also not a very functional member of an active judiciary, except that I am a very reasonably active litigant. So I don't have any qualifications of being an active participant in all of these three pillars, except that I am engaged from outside the system in whatever capacity, because we need the support of these three pillars to run an educational institution of this type. But nevertheless, I would like to lay down the context for the topic for this morning's discussion. The first pillar, namely the parliament, and what you saw in the TV channels in the last 1 week, I don't know whether you have, now you will have the confidence in the institution. You saw the tea bill, and this was how the newspaper reported the proceedings of the parliament last week. The tea bill, the Telangana bill, the tea bill was served with assault and pepper. So the tea was served with assault and pepper. This is how the Telangana bill got passed. And you saw in the legislative sessions in the Uttar Pradesh, where people were just stripping off, and the ruling party MLA challenging them to strip further to prove their manhood, and this is the type of legislative proceedings that we saw in TV channels. Fortunately, came through a Supreme Court order that interpreted the Section 8 of the Representation of People's Act, which put probably some sense into the entire mechanism. I only wish that it also had some retrospective effect, because Income Tax Act always has some retrospective effect. But acts like these type, of course, the Supreme Court said it doesn't have a retrospective effect, but it put to halt those people who are convicted from actually contesting elections and actually not being able to represent the people. But you see, the institution of parliament, of course, which needs to represent the people, the last few years we have our own questions as to whether they are effectively discharging the duty that the people have asked them to do, because they are the representatives of the people. Because they have always been telling us that we have passed this act, this act, this act, and none of us has actually questioned whether the right to information, did it guarantee action? The right to education, did it guarantee wisdom, knowledge? The right to food, is it going to guarantee nutrients? We don't ask these questions. Now the second pillar, namely the bureaucracy. Those days we had the closed system of regulation, where we did not open up. And fortunately we had very good people like Mr. TSR Subramanian, who took a very calibrated stance, who took decisions because they knew that they are discharging a huge responsibility on behalf of the government. Despite the quota raj, and despite bureaucrats having the fullest opportunity to make merry in the quota raj, we did have some fine bureaucrats who took the country in the right direction. But of course, the economic discourse globally changed, the entire system opened up. But today we see that the ratio is actually going to the other extreme, where despite all this, you know, we are not able to really get some good action in the bureaucratic machinery. There are good people, but good action is missing. And that is why probably Mr. TSR Subramanian, who fought a very big case on our behalf, the Supreme Court issued an order that, you know, said we need fixed tenures for bureaucrats. They cannot be, you know, transferred just at the whims and fancies of the ministers. And that the bureaucrat should be empowered to record the oral instructions given by the ministers. And people like him took the cause up to the Supreme Court and made sure that the machinery, the bureaucratic machinery, is insulated from political interference. So that leads to the third pillar. To what extent can judiciary save this country? Judiciary, of course, is a very, very important and critical pillar in our country's progress that it has seen in the last so many years. But the role of judiciary also needs some definitive framework within which things have to get operationalized in our country. Just as V.R. Krishnayyar very rightly said, you see, law is not a brooding omnipresence in the sky, but an operational art in society. The extent to which it can be operationalized, the Supreme Court has to exercise its wisdom. And cases of these 2G and others, it did alter the very mechanism in which decision making was made. It also went to the other extreme of saying how mosquitoes should be controlled in the state of Kerala. So are we talking about the role of Supreme Court in operationalizing as to how mosquito control program should be administered in Kerala? Definitely not. I don't think that should be the job of the Supreme Court. So there are two views on that. Judicial activism, at times a little altruistic, and the other view takes that it is judicial responsibility because they feel that this country can be saved by an exercise of very critical, responsible measure. Mr. Arun Shori very brilliantly in one of his recent lectures, I'm a great fan of Mr. Arun Shori, he delivered a lecture on governance deficit. And one important issue that he tackled was the issue of the judiciary. And he said, he gave just three important suggestions, which I think can be implemented. One was, if the case involves government servants, no adjournments at all. So you reduce the rate at which the cases against government servants get prolonged. The second, limit the arguments. You cannot keep on arguing. Limit the arguments. And in cases of corruption, the onus is on the accused to prove that he did not engage in acts of corruption. So as you know, you implement the Narcotics Act or the Terrorist Act in equal measure when it comes to the issue of corruption. He went on to quote the example of the previous Union Minister Sukram, who was caught red-handed with crores of money under his own bedroom. Then he said it's actually Sukram's responsibility to prove that because of his wife's savings attitude that he was able to actually generate so much of crores of money under the bed. But the case here is entirely different, that the government, poor government, the poor machinery which has actually served him the charge sheet had to prove that Sukram actually got this money through acts of corruption. So we need definitely an overall change in these three pillars that are very critical for a functional democracy like ours. The reason is that as a country, we are being identified as a potential of being a superpower. And I am not saying this. The National Intelligence Council, which is supposed to be the think tank of CIA, says that by 2050, there will be three major powers, the United States of America, India, and China. And if we are marching towards in that direction, then it is abundant and clear that these three pillars of our democracy needs a total change, the way in which the framework is operating, the way in which some substantive laws are being enacted. We need a total change. And how can that change happen? And that is why I requested Mr. TSR Subramanian to share his experience, his viewpoints, his perspectives, his prognosis of how the role of bureaucracy and the judiciary to a certain extent can bring about the change that can define India in the global architecture as it moves forward. So this is the context that I lay for this morning's discussion, and I'm sure all of you will definitely leave an enlightened mind after listening to Mr. TSR Subramanian. Welcome all of you again.
Thank you, sir, for wonderfully laying the context for this today's discussion. I've seen the master blaster of Indian cricket, Tendulkar, missing some opportunity and balls, but the master blaster of Shastra never miss an opportunity on stage. Always he proves and are giving a wonderful thought for us. And may now request our esteemed guest, Sri TSR Subramanian, to deliver a lecture on emerging role of judiciary and bureaucracy.
Esteemed Vice Chancellor Sutramanji, Dr. Vice Subramaniam, Dean Badrinath, Professor Saab, members of the faculty, and students of SASTRA University. Normally, when I'm invited to, I'm associated with the university, with the college. I'm also chairman of a school system about which, if I have an opportunity, Dr. Vaisuru's name has changed my agenda totally. I was coming to speak of something, he asked me to speak of something else. So if I have an opportunity, I will speak about that school. Whenever I'm invited by any school or college, old that I am, I'm very, very keen to come and meet young, fresh faces, get more inspiration. I never refuse. But today, there are two very special reasons why I immediately agreed to the kind request made by Dr. Vaisubramaniam. It was that, as he mentioned, I studied school here in Tanjore, Veer Raghavaya School, 6 years there, first form to sixth form. Passed my SSLC from here, went on to Calcutta University for a variety of reasons. That's one reason. I have an affinity to this place, I belong to this place, and I wanted to come here. I could not continue my further studies in Tanjore only because SASTRA University was not here at that time. At that time, much later, 15, 20 years later, one of my friends who went to Bern in Switzerland had the idea of a reunion of our sixth form class, 30 or 40 students. So with great trouble, we compiled that list, we did all kinds of things. Email had not come at that time. So anyway, we got through some kind of a list and we fixed a date. The reunion was, alas, in Madras, Chennai, not in Tanjore. Astonishingly, we discovered out of about 40, we were able to locate 30, and about 20, 25 people came to the reunion, and some from Dubai or from US to the reunion. And we found that of the 30 we knew and the 40, only one was in Tanjore. 39 people had left Tanjore to find work in Mumbai or in Delhi or abroad or in Madras or somewhere else. Now, the point was that Tanjore did not have the openings for the brightest minds of India to do whatever they had to do here, which is, I think much later the medical college came, much later, and soon thereafter, I think, this university came. And I have heard the second, third reason, that the accent and quality, the accent and merit, the spirit of public service and public contribution that this university represents. So these are the secondary and tertiary reasons because of which I wanted to come here. Let me come, because of the time available now, let me come straight to the point that I have no real expertise on judiciary, though I'm a consumer, so to speak, of the judiciary's work. I have no real expertise of the legislative or the legislature. I'm a consumer, so to speak, of, I'm in close contact, alas, too close contact, more than to my liking, with the legislature and the executive. So, Dr. Vaisubramaniam talked of the three pillars, the legislature, the judiciary, and the executive. Yes, very quickly we can discuss the legislature. Yes. The legislature dealt with the division of 9 crore Telugus. The 13th largest country in the world, if you were to deem the undivided Telugu Desham, undivided Andhra as one country, 13th largest country, with as much preparation and with the aplomb of cutting a birthday cake. Take a knife and cut it out. That's how the legislature dealt with that. Alas, preparation about water, about education, about property, about headquarters, all this had to be done, but I won't go into that. The two key roles of a legislature are, it is a place where information is available. Authentic information, the position of the political parties, the position of civil society, of people at large is known. That is one important element of... Secondly, government can be asked questions and authentic answers have to emerge. These are the two roles. Now, of late, neither role is being performed by the legislature. Since the advent of the right to information, it came, I had a small part to play with it because Shuri's father, I requested, H.D. Shuri, I requested him to form a committee in 1997 for right to information. We had people like Soli Sorabji and a couple of secretaries from government, part of that committee. I processed it, took it to the cabinet, it came to the parliament. It could not be passed because the Devegowda government fell at that time. We took it again to the parliament, soon the Gujarat government fell. And then 2004 or so, 2005, it became an act. It has taken 7 years to mature. Contrary to what you mentioned, in my opinion, it is going to be a very powerful tool in the hands of the people. And in the British times, the concept of information was the right to know or the need to know concept. People should be given information only when they... Today, you've got a right to know through the RTI. RTI says that it is for the individual to decide what information he will have. It is not for the government to decide what information will be shared. We have reversed the picture in terms of RTI. So the question are, in 5-6 years of RTI, we have more authentic information about government than we have had in 65 years of question hour in parliament. And that is the first aspect of change which has taken place in recent years. The second dimension is in terms of debates. I mentioned we didn't know, a lot of games were being played in parliament. We didn't know what was the innermost thoughts of the various parties, the various participants, the various stakeholders in, say, as an important issue as division of a state, the Andhra state. We get more information from TV on the debates. We get more perspectives from TV today. So, to put it crudely, I'm asking a hypothetical question. Yes, the sovereignty of the country vests with in the parliament. That is the one space where you say, sovereignty of India is there. But beyond that, what is its role? Suppose parliament were to meet only 2 days a year, say, 2 days a year. It's in that 2 days, it has only this job, that they affirm confidence in the government or throw the government out, one way or the other. Number one, they pass the budget or don't pass the budget, in which case the government falls. Number two. Number three, whatever bills are there, we had the Lokpal, which was waiting for 50 years, passed in 2 days or 1 day's time. We had the Andhra bill, which was waiting for 15 years, passed in half a day's time. 4 years back, we had 12 bills which were passed in 11 minutes. So, by voice vote, so pass all pending bills, would the country have been any worse than what we have seen in the past few years? Now, it's the question I'm raising now. I am not, don't get me wrong, I am not saying the legislature should be curtailed. This is the place our India is represented internationally through that particular forum. So I'm not criticizing it. I am saying we need to introspect. I will leave it there and go move on to the other two institutions right now. The second institution is the judiciary, and I will say the broader, the executive, belonging both to the political executive and the permanent executive, the bureaucracy. So I will deal with that rather than. Now, these are completely intertwined agencies. Therefore, when you talk about each one of them, there will be some interconnection with the other, and therefore I will go. Let's quickly come to the judiciary. One week I was giving a lecture in November, and in Delhi on some matter, I think judicial overreach on that issue. And that week there were three Supreme Court orders on that week. One on red beacon on vehicles, the other on Muzaffarnagar riots, whether proper care had been taken or not, and third was the Article 377 ruling on the Supreme Court. Now, every week you find three or four, as you said, something about mosquitoes in Kerala or whatever, etc., etc., etc. Now, very few places are there in the world where you have such repeated references to the Supreme Court nearly in every day's newspaper. But there are very few other countries in the world where the Prime Minister or the Finance Minister is referred to, the Chief Minister is referred to in the front page every year either. I spent 5 years in Geneva. Genuinely, I didn't know who the Swiss president was. I had no idea who the Swiss president was. I remember, I studied for a year in London. I remember the Harold Macmillan, the then Prime Minister of England. He came on, I was sitting there, he came on to the train, the metro underground train, and he was carrying his own briefcase and his own umbrella. He was accompanied by one, presumably, security guard or Secret Service agent, or one person was next to him. Everybody in the train looked up, they recognized the Prime Minister. Nobody moved, they all continued reading the newspapers. I was sitting there. He didn't find a seat, he looked around for a seat, couldn't find a seat, but kept on going on there. Three, four stations later, he alighted, nobody lifted his head to see. That is a democracy in action, where, now in India, the Prime Minister is referred to every day, the newspapers, Chief Minister is referred to. I think, for those who don't believe it, go to YouTube. About sometime in June, July, August, the Swiss president went to Beijing on an official trip. And at the airport, there is this video, picture of him, Swiss president, taking his own bag from the airline baggage, carrying his own bag, pushing the trolley, walking out of, and taking a taxi to the Swiss embassy. Now, the point I'm trying to make here is that our executive is visible, our judiciary is visible, and our legislature is visible every day, and the common man is not visible here. And I think that is the real point that I wish to make here. As far as judiciary is concerned, we can look at three dimensions. Very, very quickly I will do that. One is the common man's justice, the lower courts, civil and criminal courts. Then the higher judiciary, the higher courts, the appellate judiciary, and the original jurisdiction, PIL type of, the high courts and Supreme Court. And thirdly, the concept of PIL. I'll spend a few minutes on these three before I move on to the other area. We don't talk of reforms of judiciary. The Italian Marines case is now a year and a half old. We are not ready with a charge sheet, the very first element in a trial. Now, if you do a calculation all over the country, you will find large number of people in jail today who have been in jail longer than the maximum period if they had been punished and convicted and punished, they were eligible for. So the maximum punishment is 2 to 3 years' time. You could find 6 years, 8 years, 10 years. They don't have a lawyer, they don't know the law, they don't have somebody to back up. One, two, three. Now, clearly, the first basic point is justice delayed is justice denied. I remember after that attack on Twin Towers in New York, there was in Arizona that week, a Sardar driver, a taxi driver from India in Arizona, there was anger against people with a beard who attacked the Twin Tower in New York. So somebody attacked the taxi driver and killed him on the spot. I recall, there's only one witness, one eyewitness. I recall, within 6 months, He was convicted, trial was over, went on a first appeal, it was over, and he was executed within 9 months of that date. Remember the Tandoor case, if many some of you remember in Delhi, that Sharma Tandoor case, where again there was only one witness. And that one witness was the policeman who was on duty in that area. That case took 12 to 15 years. I don't know if she was executed or not, I don't know what the final position is. Just imagine in Indian conditions, in 15 years, that person could have been suborned, he could have been bought over, he could have been run over by a bus, he would have died by a heart attack, anything could have happened. What I'm trying to say is that evidence, like good wine, does not improve with age. Evidence only deteriorates. It is only, it's a non-positive sequence. Quality of evidence will always deteriorate with time. You're not going to improve with time. Memories will get short. People will get bought over. A BMW case can take 20 to 15 years. A Salman court case, Chinkara shooting, can take 15 years. Something is seriously and fundamentally wrong if these should take so much time. I think that is one very broad point. I have been in districts, and we know exactly where the problems are, that the FIR itself, the first lodging of the case report in many states, is auctioned in a sense. When the FIR is lodged, then the police inspector goes around seeing who's all interested in that and what is the bidding, whose name should be. So concurrently, six FIRs will come, only one will get recorded. And it is not unusual that a person who accuses becomes the accused of the FIR. You know, then the case starts after that. So the bidding process starts there in that area. When the FIR comes, the next is the investigation case in stage. Same kinds of problems. Then you go to the prosecution stage, where you invoke the law, the prosecutor starts looking at it again from fresh eyes, and each stage is a kind of a gold mine. You can develop a lot of, not just information, but real gold can come out of each stage in the process. So we have then the adjournment. Somebody referred to the adjournments today. Now, at the drop of a hat, you get adjournments. Then you have lawyers' supervision over where government is involved. Supervision over CBI has been a major issue now. You can't have 50% of cases before the courts, particularly higher courts, government is involved in one form or the other. You can't have government being the investigator and the prosecutor and the person who handles the case. There's something seriously wrong with the concept of proper investigation. And then you have lawyers getting away with blue murder. I'm sure a new generation of lawyers will come from here with the idea. I remember Anand, a lawyer called Anand, who was convicted in a court for suborning the witnesses in one of the high-profile Nanda case. He's practicing today. Not only that, he's representing India in International Olympic Association. Something is wrong when we have this kind of a spectacle that people who are punished, there is no deterrence. There is no will to punish. And when finally somebody is punished, it is not as a deterrent. He is taken out so that everybody else knows that if you cross the line, it can be very expensive. And that thought, if we are not conveying to various people here, then we have commissions of inquiry. I remember the Librahan Commission. I went as Chief Secretary in Uttar Pradesh about a week after the demolition of the Babri Masjid. And I remember at that time still that we had in at least 35 places in Uttar Pradesh, in about 20 districts, actual execution, murders were going on in Hindu areas. Muslims were dismembering Hindus, and in Muslim areas, Hindus are dismembering Muslims. Is actually going on at that kind of situation. When the Librahan Commission was established and asked to give its report in, I think, 2 months or 3 months' time, at that time, 1992, December, I think the first week of January, the Liberal Harm Commission was established. And it had, I think, 36 extensions. And by the time, the entire thing had no meaning at all. By the time the report came, I think, 15, 20 years later, the Jain Commission, I think the Jain Commission on the execution of Rajiv Gandhi, its report came in 1997 or 1998. And by that time, issue was not Rajiv Gandhi. The issue was the DMK's role and survival of the government. I mean, in other words, these commissions of inquiry have become meaningless. Then we have perjury. For example, in the 2002 events following that, how many cases we have seen, how can a person make two statements mutually contradictory in two different courts? By definition, one of them has to be wrong. You don't need further evidence. Once you look at a person's statement in two different courts saying two different things on oath, you don't need further proof. Straight away can be convicted of perjury. If A is right, B is wrong. If B is right, A is wrong. I mean, it's as simple as that. It's very logical. But we have this getting away. Then we have the confession, again, in post-Mumbai riots, for example. So many confessions overturned in the courts. Something is seriously wrong in the entire way in which we look at it. Then there are the high-profile cases. Why should I, when I was in Geneva in the 80s, I heard about Lalu's case. I can't hear Lalu's case 30 years later. It is as old as SASTRA University. I mean, a case, you can't have that happening. It must have a finality. Sir, your university is eternal. It will outlast all of us. It's going to be a beacon of light for the next 100 years, 200, 500 years, like good universities are hard. But a case cannot be immortal. A case has to finish. Sooner or later, the case has to finish. One way or the other, there's a concept of a case. So I think we need reforms here. Yes, the reforms in the executive, reforms in the parliament are probably of more urgency. It is to the credit of our higher judiciary that despite these glaring failures, people are not still talking of reform, because in very difficult times, our higher judiciary has stood by this country, and that's the pillar that has kept us going all these years. I think that's an important thing I think one has to understand. Time and again, and we had judges of the highest caliber. We had that judge, what was his name, was UP, after he declared Indira Gandhi's election as, imagine the courage that it took for him to declare Prime Minister of the day, her election. We have had case after case after case at that time. And we have had, fortunately, so despite the 20 problems, the warts and all that I have pointed out just now, we still consider, the average Indian considers that there is rule of law here. The average international observer looks at India and says there is rule of law here. In one sense, you can argue with these problems, the rule of law is highly distorted, yes, but there is rule of law here. And fortunately, that is due to the quality of the higher judiciary. Then comes the question of overreach. Has there been overreach? When in 1997, the Vineet Narayan judgment came on the independence of the CBI, at that time, nobody talked of overreach. They all welcomed it. Then the Vishakha judgment came. Many of you would know that. Vishakha judgment about right of the protection of women in the working place. Nobody talked of overreach. It was a gap in our constitution. And everybody felt that it is very correctly mentioned that that gap should be plugged. Right through. The concept of overreach, PIL is a concept which is very special to India. Very few judicial systems in the world has a PIL. And where did the PIL come from? The PIL comes from the Article 32 of the constitution, where we have the fundamental rights, and then there's an omnibus clause that if any fundamental right is breached, the courts, wherever the jurisdiction is, whichever it is, so if there is public distress due to mosquitoes, Article 32 can be invoked. So it is now a question of, is there large-scale distress, and are people affected? Are people's right to life, to liberty, to justice, all of these which are guaranteed in the Constitution, and who is going to decide whether that jurisdiction lies, whether the people's rights are affected or not? The Supreme Court. So, rightly or wrongly, and I think strongly rightly, we have now at least firmly said the Constitution shall be prevail, and the interpreter of the Constitution shall be the higher judiciary, the Supreme Court, and nobody shall second guess what the Supreme Court has said in interpreting the Constitution. So I don't think this should be, and the moment we resign from this position, we depart, we open 1 inch from this position, it'll tear apart. Then after that, everybody in India becomes a judge, everybody becomes an interpreter of the Constitution, and therefore it's important to maintain this. Yes, the umpire can occasionally make mistakes, bad luck, but in the long run, I would much rather have an umpire who is upright and who is straight, who is human, rather than have no umpire and let the people who play the game umpire for themselves. I think it's important that we do that. So, why has this overreach concept come? It has come on 2G. It has come on Colgate. Before that, I don't think anybody in India was speaking, because very large interests were hurt. People who control our newspapers, people who control our media, people who control TV stations, these are the people whose interests are affected, and therefore the concept of judicial overreach has come on this. Now 2G, many of you know the details, I'm very familiar with the details, I won't go into that. Let me just give you one example. In 2G, on a particular date, if I'm not mistaken, it is September 30th of 2008, if I'm not mistaken, 2006 or 2008. The first come, first served, you can argue right or wrong, old or new, the argument is flawed. The argument used was, I bought land in Noida in 1970 at 1 lakh rupees. Now its value is about 1,000 times more. 30 years later, I can't say I bought it at 1 lakh on a first come, first served basis, and therefore land will be given in first come, first. That's a different thing. Assume all of it is correct. Assume all of it is correct. The issue was that land will be given, the license will be given first come, first served basis, and the cutoff date was 30th September. On 27th September, morning 10 o'clock, a new cutoff date was given, saying many applications have come, therefore we will now have a new list on 27th September, 5 days earlier, and at 10 o'clock in the morning, the announcement is made that this is a new first-come, first-served list. Whoever comes now will be considered on a first-come, first-served basis. It also says that you should also, along with your application, deposit so many crores per megahertz as your entry fee or whatever. This was at 10:15, the announcement. At 10:36, applications come, along with bank guarantee papers attached, and the bank guarantees are dated 26, one day earlier. Now, if you see this, isn't this straight away something very seriously wrong? And like this, you have 25 such instances when you go and see the record here. And when we talk about, come talk to the bureaucracy later, when you had two secretaries, Mathur and Gopalan, Gopalan from the finance ministry, Mathur, both refused to sign. They said, I will not. And therefore, they had to wait for 3 months for a new secretary, Behura, to be brought from, parachuted from outside to come and sign the document, which is how the, no, the point I'm trying to make is, if the courts take cognizance of this and then cancel the licenses, yes, there is large collateral damage, large number of people who were genuine probably were also hurt. But what do you do? That is the nature of the things. So what is the choice with the court? The choice with the court is, when there is clear violation of the procedure prescribed by the government and it has not been followed, do we proceed with that or say, thanks. Or thank you. Or we say, Colgate. I'm one of the petitioners in the Colgate case. There is very, very similar things. Parak, who is a Secretary Cole at that time, who is a good friend, his book is going to come out now, hopefully, the next 2-3 months. I'm writing the foreword for that book now. He's written chapter and verse what has happened. you will now see the annexures, which will now detail exactly what has happened. It's mind-boggling the way things are proceeded. Just to give you one instance. They say, okay, we'll now be open, and therefore we advertise. All previous papers thrown aside, you advertise afresh. 200 applications come for a particular coal block, and then somebody comes and picks 83, 92, 118. Rest can go home. Now, what is the basis of that? I mean, there is somebody rightly or wrongly has to say, my basis for choosing these three, I mean, let it be height, let it be weight, let it be somebody. They're saying that names are beginning at random, starting with A or K, something, some logic, right? So the point is, when we talk of judicial overreach, it is highly motivated. I am not suggesting that the higher judiciary is infallible. I am not suggesting that there is no personal prejudices coming in, there's no personal angles coming in. I'm not suggesting that. All this probably would be there in any human institution. It would always be there, that people's preferences, people's predilections, all of them would have some value. But the point is, this criticism is extremely motivated, and so I will come to the executive just now. The courts have been forced to enter the picture in large instances. I don't think by choice. I think the PAL mechanism is a wonderful mechanism if it is used in moderation, if it is used to stitch at the end where the gaps are there, not to come and run the boat, run the bus, but to see minor things like the tire goes wrong, fill it, but it can't do the main job. But unfortunately, it is forced to intervene as required, number one. Number two, it is clear response to executive failure. It's a response to failure. So 2G, Colgate, these are instances of executive failure. And look, India cannot be a long-term player in the field of industry or in the field of finance unless we set our house in order. We cannot have, over time, crony capitalism. We cannot have a university which will last 500 years, not run on merit. These are fundamentals now. You cannot say, this will go on, that will go on, but I will be immortal. No, there are certain fundamental laws. So if Hong Kong or Singapore or Japan or US or Germany are long-term players in the field of industry and finance, etc., they have by and large set their houses in order, and they cannot say, a little bit of corruption is okay, do it in moderation. Make sure, no, you've got to have clear rules, clear system, and strong punishment. Would Rajat Gupta be punished in India? Most companies do 20 times, 50 times what Rajat Gupta did in US. There's an example. It is rubbish to say he was an Indian and therefore he had to be attacked in America. No, Rajat Gupta had to be punished because the message had to go, our stock exchange system is sacrosanct. Anybody who plays with it and gives inside information needs to be dealt with very, very strongly. And that message has to go so that one Rajat Gupta can shore up or preempt 10,000, 20,000 such cases. That is the concept of deterrence. There's a concept of preemption and prevention. And that is exactly what has happened in the case of Rajat Gupta. And lastly, I will also say that I have had some familiarity with the PAL system due to the civil services PAL, which will come to very, very quickly. The courts have been reluctant to come in. In fact, my own PIL, which I'll come to just now, the courts were so convinced of the case. And I was hoping that they'll give me this much. But they gave me only this much opening because they're afraid of the criticism that they're entering into territory not belonging to them, they're entering into territory belonging to the executive. So I think in summation, I would say that thank goodness we have the PIL system. We are still an immature democracy. And you mentioned that 2050, I will come to that at the end. Sir, India should have been rivaling China and USA in 2014. If we had used the last 60 years properly, today, not 2050, today we should have been equal to them in terms of economy, in terms of education, in terms of health, in terms of satisfaction of the people, in terms of any of the indices. Okay, we have forgotten all that. 2050 is still 30 years away, 35 years away. We only need 25 years more given the human talent that we have. I will come to that chapter at the end now. Let me quickly turn on to the bureaucracy, and after that, I will sequence the transition. When I say bureaucracy, I'm looking at the bureaucracy-politician interface, and therefore I'm looking at the executive in broad terms. While focusing on the bureaucracy, it will also look at the political executive. What was the Mughal day principle? That 200 years of Mughal rule, 150 years of Mughal rule, it's a Sun Tzu principle that you as a local chieftain can do what you want, provided you are loyal to me, provided you don't, I have the suzerainty over you, and you can, you got total freedom to make what you want. So each Nawab, Sub-Nawab, Nawab's Nawab was a boss everywhere and at all levels. So that's an accepted principle that to some extent Government of India has become like that. At every level they have delegated, he says you may do total freedom to do whatever you want, provided you are loyal to the top cascadingly. British days, the orders came from Whitehall, no telex, no emails, nothing. It was telegraph came even later. Telegraph came around middle of the 19th century. They were here even earlier. So it was a two-month boat journey away for orders there. That means the local person had full control, and the viceroy or the governor general earlier, the viceroy later, and then the district magistrate and the secretariat. They ran India like benevolent tyrants. What they said was final. It was law. There was nobody above them. For the average district magistrate, the chief secretary, the average chief secretary, it was the governor or the viceroy who was the law. And deliberately, they had a person who was not well versed in administration as the governor. If you notice there, the ICS used to be the collectors and the secretaries, and you had a politician from England coming as the viceroy or the governor. And a very simple formula they had. The viceroy is only to keep a benevolent eye on what's happening. He does not interfere. So one governor general, one viceroy was asked, so many files are coming. How do you handle these files? What do you do with those files? He said, I got a very clear formula that every file I clear, every seventh file I say, I don't agree and send it back. It works very well. Why do you send it back every seventh? He says, I have to tell him who is the boss. So this was understood. So every seventh file will make an absurd proposal, so that it is refused. So it would come back. So then he would vary his says, if it is Monday, it will be seventh file. If it is Tuesday, ninth file, you know, et cetera, et cetera. The point I'm trying to make here is that it was a system where there was no minister, there was no MLA. Now, in 47 or 50, when we had the constitution, 47 independence came, this was the situation. Imagine the change which took place. Instead of having your boss 5,000 miles away, 4,000, 3,000 miles away, the boss is here. The boss is in Delhi, the boss is in Chennai, the boss is in Madras in those days, the boss is in Lucknow. And more than that, the boss is in district headquarters. He is in Tirunelveli, he is in Birbhum, and he is in Pilibhit. He's the MLA, he's the local MLA. Now, this took five to, can you say, I'm trying to convey a point here, that somehow our constitution makers did not comprehend the enormity of the change. They thought things as usual, the machinery will continue, the police machinery will continue, the entire system secretariat will continue, only ministers will come in, MLAs will come in. They are not understood that these are organic things. These are not mechanical parts. These are things which grow on each other. These are organic development has to take place. They will all interact with each other. It took 20, 30 years for the interaction to take place. So only by 70s we start seeing now. I have been privy to from 60 onwards I have seen, people became MLAs only for the pride of being an MLA. Many people who are great contribution had come here to give something, to give the weight of their personality, to weight of their benevolence, to support the administration. This was, I can, chapter and verse, I can mention the number of people there in UP those days. I mean, Now, progressively, what happened? I'll give you three, four quick examples that you'll understand. In 70s, this man called Tanjan from Kerala, there was a leather export promotion council. Those days, air travel had just started. So the members of the council were given airfare. So there was a private gentleman, I've forgotten his name now. He had been private secretary to Jagjivan Ram, who used to be much earlier the railway minister. So he had those days the gold pass. There was no AC those days, only first class was there. Gold pass means he can travel anywhere in India, very few, limited given, personal privilege of the railway minister. Forgot his name now. Anyway, he was a member of the council. So he came for the meeting for which I went to in Bombay. From Delhi, he went back to Delhi, and after that, Tanjan gave the story that he gave his TA bill. And the TA bill included travel from Delhi to Delhi to Bombay and back by air. And at the end, as usual, there's a certification. Certified that I undertook the journey in the manner in which I have mentioned here. Now, Tanjan said, as a matter of fact, this gentleman's name forgotten, he was on the same train with him from Delhi to Bombay. And the meeting was over. Second day, he took the train from Bombay to Delhi, both journeys. Right through two of them, they're chatting all the time. And 4 days, 5 days later, the bill comes. So I asked Tanjan, what did you do? So he says, sir, what can you do? I approved it. I said, look, what have you done? I mean, unto true to yourself. Sir, he's a politician, sir. I don't want to tangle with him. Now, do you see the microcosm? Do you see how the degeneration has taken place? Now, I would say that if I were Tanjan's boss, I would send him to jail. I will say that you are accessory after the fact. You know exactly what has happened. You should not have done what you did, etc., etc. This is one story. The other story was the same time, a good friend of mine, many of you know about him. This is a story I have written about. This is a story I tell in presence of him. N.K. Singh, who is now Rajya Sabha MP. About him, I talk about him. He's a good friend, therefore I can tell you openly. N.K. Singh, I would say, was the Dubash. He represented the bureaucracy to the politician. He represented the politician to the bureaucracy. And he translated the Dubash like a Dubash. And he took benefit from both sides. And he taught the minister what are the loopholes. He taught the minister that like an assembly line, money can be made. License can be given. The process of giving a license and how the money can be made. That you apply here, it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter a damn. If you know anything about steel plant, etc., you apply for 100 tons of steel here, or an import license here. It will come through the process. And in between, there's a drawer like this. You put the money here, and here you'll get the license out. So this system, like a factory, this was manufactured. So N.K. Singh was the first star. They called it at that time special assistant. He is the first time India moved to a parliamentary form of governance to a presidential form of governance. Hitherto, we had the British system where the advice was given by the chamber and there will be secretaries who would write up and down. The first time when you don't need the secretariat, you only need the minister with three, four assistants, become presidential form, handpick the people. So you can see that mostly in states. In most states are now run by 8-10 people. When somebody asked me, if and when, which is likely, Modi comes as prime minister, sir, this is a very large country, running Gujarat is so easy, relatively. How can he run such a large country with 10? I said, no. Reagan ran US, probably the best president US ever had. Reagan ran with 10 handpicked people. It's a question of, like in computer science, you keep, cascading, multiplying by 10. And you have phalanxes coming here. So that was where we started becoming from a parliamentary democracy to presidential form. That is okay, provided you do it eyes open, after discussion, after looking at the checks and balances, making sure it will work, and then transfer. And lastly, one example to give, the changing times. We had, this again I've written in the book, so I'm not... disclosing or sharing any. Chennareddy was the executive governor during president's rule in Uttar Pradesh after the Indira Gandhi, after the emergency, and then before the Samyukta Dayak Dal government came, 77, 78, the period after the emergency. Chennareddy, those 3-4 months, elections took place. He chose me as the executive secretary, so I worked with him closely. Now, Chennareddy wanted to, I discussed the case with you, wanted to promote a lecturer, a lady lecturer, in the dental college in Lucknow as a professor. That was as simple as that. And this was for extremely personal reasons between Chennareddy and that lady. Anyway, files went up and down, up and down, up and down. Suddenly, the elections took place. 5 days from now, the new government is to come in now. So at that time, it had not come. So he asked me, Subramanian, where is that file? I want that file urgently today. So I called the medical secretary. I said, sir, governor wants the file. Send it away to me today, immediately. So he says, come on, don't you know? It's an absurd case. There's nothing there. It's a stupid case. I said, I know all that. I'm convening to you. The governor wants that file. It didn't come. So finally, 2 days before the popular government, he said, that file must be in the desk. Please call him. So Ghulam Hussain was called, promoted PCS officer. He came and sat down. No. Governor, who asked you to sit down? He stands up. Have you been told to send the file? Yes, sir. How many times have you been told? Many times, sir. Who is governor in this state? Ghulam Hussain or Chennareddy? Chennareddy. Do you own the file? No. Have I ever stopped you from writing what you want on that file? No. I want you to write what you want on that file. That file belongs to the government of UP. I am the custodian of the government of UP, not you. Write what you want, but I want it tonight by 6 o'clock on my desk. You can go. That evening, the file comes. Ghulam Hussain wrote a 7-page note attacking the proposal, why it can't be done, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Took it to the finance secretary. Finance secretary wrote a 2-page note agreeing with him. Took it back to Ghulam Hussain. Ghulam Hussain wrote 2-page note saying, so 10 pages all written between about 9 to 10 in the morning and about 6 in the evening. It comes there. Who says government doesn't work? Government works very hard. So it comes at 6 o'clock. He sees that. He says, Chennareddy tells me, Subramanian, I have tremendous respect for Ghulam Hussain, but I want this approved. I said, sir, there have been 30 reasons why it can't be done. How can you approve it? No, it must be approved. I want it approved. Write a note for me approving it. So I said, sir, I can't. The arguments are impeccable, impossible to beat that. He says, no, I'm doing it now. So write for me. So I wrote a 2-line order, clearly mentioning on the file that I disagree, but governor wants to do it. It is right. And governor, now today, no governor, no minister, except probably Raja, would do it, that kind of a thing today, anywhere in India. He's afraid of the courts, afraid of getting caught. And therefore, they have now suborned the system by saying, I will choose the man who will be there. So minister, till my time as cabinet secretary, I will not allow. I had fights with Mulayam Singh. I had fights saying, sir, I go today. I will not allow the DMs to choose. Today, they allow people at all levels. Each minister chooses his people so that he does not have to say anything. Everything comes ready-made. In fact, frequently, the minister asks questions why it should be done. He's explained to him why it should be done. He agrees finally, reluctantly, quote-unquote. He agrees finally. So that is a system today, which I think the last story I gave. So these were economy of shortage, economy of corruption. 90s became a politics of business. I mentioned what I'm saying. I'll tell you just a short story to say how the system deteriorated there. I just come back from Geneva, 11 years out of UP. We had a service week where service people were there. So the chief minister used to be the guest of the IAS. 300 IAS officers. He is giving the address here like this to them in Hindi. He says that, like this. You're all very intelligent people. You're all very well-educated people. Society holds you in high respect. In retrospect, society did 30 years back, not anymore. Society holds you in high respect. Hindi mein, aap sampanna log hain, that is, you got everything, whatever you need in life. Sampanna log hain, sampanna is, many people know, sampanna, sampanna log hain. You are educated, you get good medical facilities, you can send your children abroad. Why do you come and touch my feet? Why do you come and ask me for a favor? If you do that, I will give you what you want. I will take from you 10,000 times what I gave you. 10,000 times, that's the price. So look, they're so open. It's as simple and as open as it is now. And that is the kind of a transformation. So we have now come to the next decade where politics has become pure business. Moved from public service, it has moved nakedly to own a business. And somebody said today, I think quoted somewhere in a book, that the average cost of an MLA's ticket investment is 20 crores, MP is 30 crores, and 40 lakhs is the officially permitted number. In my recent book, I have blasted the election commission. Why don't you have secret agents? Why don't you book people who exceed the limits? Why don't you have NGOs reporting to you, etc., etc.? Now, why? Session did that. Session was able to handle muscle power in elections. He used all his clout. Today you have technology, you have video cameras, you have all this. Why don't you do all that? Number one. Number two, if you invest 20 crores and your chance of winning is 1 in 4, say, so your investment really is 80 crores. And if you invest 80 crores, unless you get a 5 to 6 times return in 5 years, you're the biggest idiot to take this kind of a chance. So that means an MLA's post is a 500 crore business. Yeah, a good university, a good college, a good hospital, that is the dimension of the country. So when you invest so much and so much return has to come, that money is not yours. That money has come from various well-wishers who will want the moment you are successful. They will want that pound. That man, businessman, probably has invested in all the four candidates. 5 crores each or 1 crore each, he has invested. He will get 20 times return. So this is the dynamics of what has happened. So unfortunately, it has become a total business. So we have now a situation where the public servant has to become a private servant. And it breeds a set of people who are ready to crawl when they are asked to bend. Not even otherwise, not asked to bend, they bend and crawl. So this unfortunate is, let me not get it wrong. I know the system well. I know it for the last 50 years. There are still the most outstanding people, the people with the highest sense of honor. But like Gresham's law, it is people slowly getting eroded. So the number of people coming, it is still not alarming. The country is still run well because of very high quality people who still are able to stand up even today. I can't say, I've given you a sequential decade by decade photo. I can't say decade later, if the present situation, what it happens, I do not know. So all I can say is today that the politician in that system, like a tiger looking for the weakest deer, the deer is limping slightly, he is pounced there. And illustrate this, I'll just finish, within 5 minutes I'll finish. Illustrate this, in UP again in 1994, the IAS officers of UP had a ballot, secret ballot, to select and shame, to identify the four most corrupt among themselves. Now, can you imagine any group anywhere in the world, either any doctors, lawyers, judges, politicians, engineers, professors, whoever, businessmen, investors, choosing four most corrupt among themselves to shame them and put them on the notice board saying these are four people to shun or to ostracize. Four people were selected, secret ballot. Within 10 years, two became chief secretaries. superseding people. One of them died, unfortunately. He was ready. He was going to become in the few 3-4 months later. One of them died. Other one had a tangential case from somewhere in the past, which caught up with him. Because sometimes delays in law also help sometimes. So it, an old, the point I'm trying to make is that it is a system that now needs reform. So it needs to be changed. I'll come to the last point, which I'm adding just now. Human institutions can never function in a straight line. Either they can go up and go down or go up and go down. And like individuals, the health will not remain constant. They're up and down, up and down. Unfortunately, in our country, for the last 10, 15, 20, 25, 30 years, I would time it from the time of emergency, the decline has started. And at that time, I would also, just like there was this failure at the time of independence, that we didn't recognize the change, the enormity of the change in the system, that the leader or the boss who was 5,000 miles away has now come amidst you or within you. It was not taken into account. Checks and balances were not built in, which Santanam and 62 understood the need for a Lokpal was not built in. The second dramatic mistake was in the 70s when Indira Gandhi spoke of a committed bureaucracy. She probably meant it in a good sense, commitment to programs, commitment to policies, commitment to implementation. But as all human things are, it got degenerated to commitment to a party, commitment to an individual, and therefore, which a civil servant in Indian conditions cannot be. So, we have had a secular decline since the mid-70s, in the last 30, 35 years. And I believe both in our governance, in our economy, and in our culture, in all the three dimensions, these are mutually interacting. And towards the last 10, 15 years, that slow secular decline has become steeper. The angle of decline has become faster. Now, as you see motor planes, etc., frequently, when the angle of decline becomes fast, there is loss of stability, and rather than cut, it can crash. It's possible. Don't think Yugoslavia is too far away. Don't think Egypt is too far away. Don't think Syria is too far away. They're all in this world. They're all, you know, by email, they're only nanoseconds away. And therefore, we should not be too complacent in this particular matter. So human systems, human institutions cannot be static. We have had a study, but I see now new trends in the last 2-3 years that the decline has been arrested and new systems are slowly starting to come. And over time, I suspect that I'll give you only 3-4 instances of this before I conclude. RTI I have mentioned just now, don't underestimate its powers. Don't underestimate the 2G or the 3G. I am a signatory now to this PIL on Reliance Gas. We cannot continue our public affairs through crony capitalism. It just will not survive. It may give benefits today. It may appear to be temporary palliative today. But over time, don't say, don't rock the boat. We need the manthan. We need the cleaning up at whatever cost. Because the potential of this country is enormous. Let me digress for a second and say, I'm chairman of a school system, very interesting school system, in half a minute. We choose 10 children from each district of Uttar Pradesh. There are 78 districts, 800 children. We put them in class 6 to class 11. Each year, they keep going. We started 4 years back. The senior most children are in class 10 now, class 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. CBSE syllabus, 3 criteria, that the school should be a pure village school, should not be a town, should not be a municipal area, should not be a notified area, should not be a corporation area, it should be a village school, number one. Number two is that child should be below poverty level, should be landless labor, local 1, 2, 3, 4, below whatever official, with a certification which verify. A couple of cases where the certification were wrong, they thrown the children out even second, third year. And third, they should be first in their own school. And after that, so 300 such schools, we choose 10 through a two-tier computerized competitive examination run by an outsider. So nobody can influence the election to that, purely on merit. Now, this happened for fourth year now. First year, when the children came, I went to the inauguration, along with Shiv Nadar, who funds it, I chair the school, and I did like this. What have we gotten into? The children looked so bedraggled and so, and then the parents looked even worse. 4 years later today, and they come from some of the most backward districts in India. You can't imagine. In Tamil Nadu, you have no district which can rival a Pilibhit. You can rival in UP Devariya or a Pilibhit. You have no imagination in, those of you who have not been to UP have no imagination of conditions there. So they come from all over and all from rural areas, as I said now. This year alone, they come with zero English. The children now, and no reservation, no caste reservation, no boy-girl reservation. This year alone, they have competed with Delhi Public School, Dune School, Rishi Valley, in elocution contests, in a number of contests, number one. My calendar for 2014 is their computer artwork, number two. Number three, my decoration in the school, in the room like this, is all computer work. One child, a freestyle drawing, Toyota program, international program. The Indian program she has won, she is going to Tokyo to compete in international level final in Tokyo. Now the point I'm making is, there is so much talent in this country, sir, which you have recognized. You have brought this institution here. There is so much of talent in this country that in every corner, every village, you have got people. I'm not saying everybody is a world beater. If 3 to 4 to 5% of Indians can make waves in Harvard or in Stanford or in Oxford, imagine you extend this 5% to 50, 60, 70 coverage there. So give them basic education, good quality education, give them exposure to good health, give them exposure to minimum standards of living, the country will be world beaters. So this, and what we have not done is the simplest thing, exposure, opportunity. That's only the simplest kind of a thing to do we have not done. We wanted to go to the moon, we want to do this. So the answer to your question is yes, I think it's doable here. We have not done it. We have today not competed with China and US, which we ought to have. In my view, in the last 60 years, India should now have come back to be the number one country in the world. We have not done that, but don't despair. It may not happen in my lifetime. Don't despair, because earlier we didn't do it because we didn't understand. If we did understand, we didn't have the will to do it, political will to do it. These are two prerequisites. And maybe 30 years back, we couldn't have done it. The problems are so large. With technology, you can now take education to the remotest village. You can now take public health to the remotest village. Just to give you an example, you can just take two trucks, school by school, village mandi by village mandi. You can do the blood test, ECG, etc., by trucks there. You can have live VSAT connectivity. You can have 4G connectivity to a bank of doctors in Tanjavur or in Chennai. You can have live feedback of the treatment to be given. So the villager cannot come to the hospital because it is 2 days' wage gone for him, which he cannot afford. He is such a low level of existence. If you take it to him, you can dramatically change. The concept of micronutrient is not there. The point, Dr. Vaisubrahmanyam, is yes, we should do it. We need stability. I think that understanding is coming all over India, that it is a problem which has to be addressed. Our problem is not politics. It is political stability. It is good governance. These are issues which are now coming to the fore now. So all we can hope, I'm not a politician, I hope we have 10 years of good governance. And we now, India had 50,000 miles of railways in 47. In 2014, we have 70,000, 40% more. Same time, China has 12 times the mileage of railways, the same period. Similar thing for electricity, 1, 2, 3, 4. All these are highly doable. Technology has come which can contribute very significantly to these. So my bet would be 2040. 10% cushion we have. 2040, it can be achieved in 2/3 of this century. India can still be there. Thank you very much.
Before we open up the floor for questions, I just want to stand corrected. The NIC, the National Intelligence Council report, mentioned 2030. So you have given 10 years bonus, so thank you for the bonus as well. So we'll take few questions, and let me begin the question and answer session with the first question that I have. You have very seriously expressed concern, quoting examples of Syria, Egypt, Syria, Egypt, Libya, these are all theocratic societies. And my confidence is that in a democratic society like ours, the constitution is supreme, and I still have the fullest hope that it is going to protect the sovereignty of our nation. But the question is the creation of the constitution through the constituent assembly debates. At that time, in a single political ecosphere was this debate conducted, and hence the constitution was created. Now, using that as a tool, today we find lot of statutory enactments. For example, I said the Representation of the People Act. Our polity is poor, but I don't think our politicians are so dumb that they will wait for 90 days from being convicted in a lower court and then say, you see, I'm not filing an appeal and hence I am debarring myself. They are not that dumb. So anyway, an appeal is going to be filed and hence they continue their journey of being a very successful business politician, as you rightly put it. Now the court has intervened and set it back. The question is, do you think now the time is right for a good constituent assembly debate? Because the representation is, we have a lot of political parties, different ideologies, different type of architecture to each of the party. Do you think the time is right now for a new constituent assembly debate?
Very difficult questions you have raised, because if the correct will is not there, no amount of debate is going to help you in this matter. You heard probably Ajit Duwal yesterday. I was not here to hear his views, etc., etc. What has happened in Naxalism? Naxalism has happened because, or Maoism has happened, because there are large tracts with very little education, most backward parts of India, and it is like a tinder box. So one messiah comes and lights fire, the whole thing catches fire. Now, and don't underestimate it now, I think out of about 500 odd districts in India, about 203 are affected, about 60 are badly affected, 140, small or large extent. So, when instability comes, when large-scale dissatisfaction comes, the words like constitution, like for example, when large-scale, these words, constitution, of articles will go away, if passions take over, the president had mentioned last month, anarchy, the word anarchy, in a particular context now. So the point I'm trying to make is, you can very easily, India fortunately has been integrated very well now in the last few years. There is inter-movement, etc. It is very easy to arouse passions in terms of language, religion, caste. So India is a melting pot. So it will be very careful here to bring these elements together, everything that you do. So when I say it may not be a revolution like in Libya, which you say has been engineered elsewhere, or in Iraq, which may be an oil war in a different form. You may have different ways in which these things happen, but we can find our own way of going down also. I'm an optimist. I find that five new major things have happened in the last 2 years. One is the media in India. which is with all its raucousness, with all its negative aspects which I know from inside, and despite the fact it is highly controlled, it is still on the side of the angels. It still articulates, number one. Number two, our politicians have become our rulers. The media is bringing down to earth. I have seen in one program saying you are a liar 5 times the same program. The minister dare not go and leave the program. Number two, I said RTI has come. Civil society has come. Lokpal has come. I'm not debating how much it will do. It will have enormous, because the Lokpal is a suspending authority to ask a person to stay out till he is exonerated. Civil service reforms, I didn't have time to develop that, has come. So I think we are on the upswing. Now it's not going to happen. I'm very positive. So I mentioned in the context that if we had continued without reform, I'm not sure. I think now we're on the upswing.
Yes, sir. Can you give the microphone to him? Please use the mic, sir. We're recording this session. Yeah.
You briefly touched upon the good work that the Apex Court is doing. Now, judiciary holds executives accountable for delays in decision making. Recent commutation of death sentence is a case in point. Whereas you also said justice delayed is justice denied. So how about accountability for the judiciary for the inordinate, unconscionable delays on their part in deciding cases, number one. Number two, sir, with all due respect to the Apex Court, Supreme Court, it is reliably reported that the Supreme Court sits only for 189 days in a year. Rest of the days are taken by holidays, or summer vacation, etc. So do we think that judicial reform is the need of the hour? If so, how to go about it?
Sir, I think it's a very good question. Mainly because reform for other sectors is in a debate. This has not been in public eye for a variety of reasons. I think you are right. But I think these problems need to be set right. I mentioned 10 or 12 problems there. We need now a proper good look at it. And in fact, the judiciary itself should introspect and should itself take, rather than leave it to government, then inter-agency or inter-institutional rivalries will start coming in. And therefore, it is important judiciary itself starts the process rather than the executive or the legislature, where it can have a different dimension. I think it is important that But we have so many other more pressing problems relating to poverty, relating to public health, etc. I am not saying we should do them sequentially, but I think sooner or later the debate should start and it will start. To my mind, it is mainly a question of procedure. So once upon a time, I remember when I was district magistrate in UP, one sub-inspector will have to come 10 times or a murder case from area posting just to prove that he did some activity he did there. Today videos have come, there are systems which are coming, and affidavits can be made from across India. You don't physically have to come, and rules like zero adjournments, 1, 2, 3, number of things can be made, and the American judicial system has found, and we have talked of criminal cases now. The system is 20 times worse for revenue cases and for civil cases. So we need now reform. One last point you mentioned about holiday, I was of the same opinion till now. But having seen the judges, you know, each judge gets about 2,000, 3,000 pages of documents for each case. Now, and he has 10 cases a day. So I would like him to go through the pages. You know, it's important. So I think at that level, it is not only the physical, he's not like a rickshaw driver. I mean, number of hours he puts in. It is also the intellectual quality that he brings into it. There I would like to be a little more charitable and say, I want higher quality judgment rather than number of hours he puts in. That would broadly be my view.
Yeah. So with humility I endorse this, because that's the order of the Supreme Court is law of the land. So that's the finality, and you need time for them to actually lay down the law. It's not that the remaining days they are on vacation, they are writing orders. Secondly, the first point, as you said, is very important. No more, you know, accommodative justice. We need adjudicative justice, sir. Yes, sir.
Today, if you see, many of the youngsters are motivated by money. Now, when money becomes a motivating factor, you cannot use ethical routes so easily. So many of the unethical routes have started mainly because of money is a motivating factor. That also damages the long-term values which we have generated in India over the years. For example, my father was a civil engineer from College of Engineering, Indy. And he was working in highways honestly. For honesty, every 1.5 years, I was transferred from place to place. And when I finished finally from Ramakrishna Mission, I was the best outgoing student. So what happened, I asked to ask my father, why didn't you get your promotion? He got only one promotion. So he said that I was very honest and very happy because my children are honest today. See, he was taking the value through the generation to generation. His family also should be honest throughout. And that is how he enjoyed his life. Now today, what I see from youngsters is that they're all going for money. And money, they know that ethical routes is not that easy to get so much. Whereas unethical is in faster way you can get it. Throughout the world, that fever is now prevailing. Now under these circumstances, how do you expect that we can grow ourselves in terms of value and progress the country also? Thank you.
Sir, the question is a complicated question, but a simple question. You yourself gave the answer. This is not years. Ours is immemorial. For centuries, we have had the tradition in the country, in this country. We have somehow lost our moorings. We have got into a negative spiral now. When the positive spiral comes, I personally think that we need to rethink our entire education process. We need to bring values into the primary, pre-primary and primary schooling systems. And don't forget that the pedagogy required at preschool, primary, lower secondary, higher secondary, college, higher college and PhD levels are different. There is no pedagogy school in India. I mean, we don't have a high quality pedagogy either. And I think in the name of secularism, every religion says the same. There is no reason why we cannot convey what every religion says. I think it is important that we need to go back to India's culture, why we have survived, why India has been two-thirds of mankind's history. India was the foremost country in the world. We are not also rans. We were the foremost because we are the richest culture. Everything that has happened in this world has happened in India. We have that wisdom available with us. So your point is a very good question. Answer is, we have gotten ourselves into too petty, narrow thinking with vote bank politics, with all kinds of things which divert our attention. Schooling should be rich. Schooling should be arithmetic, language, plus wholesomeness. I think we need to bring that back into our life. And only a new generation will come up recognizing India's greatness in the past. And this is not being communal or casteist. This is India's system has all this in its. I agree with you.
You began answering my question actually. My next question is about education. When we start discussing reforms needed in judiciary, execution, and the political systems, should we not start thinking about reforms in education? Because if we have rightly educated people in all these three pillars of the country, then people with the knowledge and wisdom can rule the country, and perhaps in 2030 we can achieve what you said in 2040 we can achieve. And the point is, people who are engaged in education itself, including the teachers and the administrators, they themselves are not clear about what is education. Education is entirely different from acquiring educational qualification. And many people today in India itself think that the English education, or talking in English powerfully, vociferously, is only a reflection of a clarity of mind. So how to actually eradicate or filter all these things and get into the root of education, address the issue of bringing the wholesome and the educated children and improve the countries?
Sir, how to will come immediately if you know this has to be done. You have given the answer there. We have enough people. Once the thought comes, it's very high priority in India that we need to rethink our education system at all levels. And you have the right people working on this. It will come, hopefully, it will come now with any change. I bet that in the next few months, somebody is going to look at the entire education structure. And we have now new tools available. See in what manner it can be revamped, bring new technology, but old ideas, bring them together. How do you, I think this, that period is going to start now.
Yeah. English, you have to realize the fact that English today is wrongly treated as a status and not just another language. Because US and the number two economy, Japan, no English. Germany, France, no English. Japanese, you will see him wearing the finest costumes, Rolex watch, finest shoe, finest car, but he'll never talk English. I had
Sir, namaste. Had a fantastic talk from you. You had been very close, observing nearly for more than 3-4 decades, where the effective use of power as well as abuse of power. Use of power as well as abuse of power. And there is a systemic disintegration which you have explained how we are into this situation. India is a country wherein now we have got rich value systems, no need to get into new things and introduce anything. But what is one prescription, how to effectively implement these things? That is what lacking in today. That I need to understand so that it will be useful for the next generation.
The question of implementation will come. In everything, in my view, the policy is only 5%. Implementation is 95%. But that 95% will not start. The policy is not there. You know, as somebody pointed out to me, in the last 10 Republic Day speech or Independence Day speech, all over the world, the speaker says, we will give you clean government, or we will try to give you clean government. He said, nobody has said it in India. So I asked Sheila, my close friend, who was chief minister in UP, in Delhi, I asked Sheila ji, why nobody has said, at least for form's sake, that we will bring clean government. Yeah, Raman, don't be stupid. Nobody will believe it. The point is, if a credible statement comes from, I have seen not many, but a few honest politicians. I have seen, genuinely honest politicians I have seen. Even they will not speak of cleanliness, because the moment they speak, they feel that their position may get affected, their own politics will get affected. So therefore, it is important that the senior most leader must start saying, I'll clean up. He may not clean up overnight, it's a process. And all the things I mentioned, they're all processes. Don't expect them to give results tomorrow. Like education is a process. 5-6 years, you get educated. 10 years, you get 50 years, you get educated. And therefore, this process must start in India, and it will happen. And implement, I can tell you, if the will is there, it will happen. If the will is not there, if you don't try, it will never happen.
We'll take the last question.
So thank you for your speech, sir. And my question is, in 2 or 3 months away, we have general elections. And I am afraid of electing any member from our constitution because party. No party or our my area, because no party is good, and no either ruling party is good or the opposite party is good. Ruling party criticizes the opposite party criticizes the ruling. And what is your suggestion to the youngsters?
See, if I give you advice, I can be under the People's Act, I can go to jail for giving you advice on how to vote.
No, actually, even you see...
No. I think your conscience will tell you what to do. I think you should do the right thing. I am not a political person, and I don't want to talk about that. But the point is, I am a very positive person. As you said, I am a very optimistic person. India is still maturing. You will now see mature politics coming into the country. You will see new things coming into the country. I will not be despondent. You go by your conscience and you do that. The very thought has come. You are searching for the right person. That's enough. The goal will come there.
Yeah, we'll take a question from the student and then last question from Dr. Badri here. Yeah.
Sir, our country accommodates a great level of both religious, caste and other kinds of pluralism. And our country is a host to a great variety of people. And do you think that the people who have been elected by, according to the Representation of People's Act, the people who have been elected by the people, to a certain extent, their representation is curtailed by the presence of an anti-defection law because of the fact that they have to partake in whatever the party leadership tells and not what they personally believe in. Do you think that pluralism is it acts as a deterrent, that the anti-defection law acts as a deterrent to that pluralism?
I agree to this extent that the law, anti-defection law, which came in for a different route, that votes should not be purchased in parliament, which is again a valid route. Because of that, anti-defection law came, and also to provide a measure of stability, government should not change too often by votes being purchased. I agree with you, this prevents people voting with a conscience. So there should only be certain bills where the stability of the government is involved, where I think this should apply. The whip should apply. The whip should not apply to others. The conscience vote should be allowed everywhere else, number one. But number two, this is only one of the reforms. We need a total rethink of this. The fundamental problem is there are no checks and balances on the political class. I'm not against them. They are ourselves. The democracy, they come from ourselves, they represent us. So we cannot abuse our own people. But we have not created our fault, we have not created, the constitution has failed there. And we need to create, I think the three or four things which are happening now are now creating checks and balances on them. US has survived as a thriving, they're very honest domestically, they're very dishonest internationally, but within their country they're very, very honest and even-handed. They have thrived for so many centuries only because they had the principle, we will trust everybody, but we will verify everybody, however high he is, to the hilt. So even the president is bound by a number of checks and balances. Everybody is bound by committees and checks. Every appointment is scrutinized in public. Do you know that? Every senior appointment, 70 to 80 page questionnaire comes to the website, discussed by the whole country. So everything is brought out there and openly the elections are taking place. So the key point is we need, and in a democracy, people have to assert themselves. We cannot outsource our governance to some leaders. Everybody has to work and make sure together that the leaders do the right thing. So I think that consciousness, as I said, I'm very positive that consciousness is coming now, I think. It's coming. I'm very positive it's coming now.
Last question, sir.
When the whole public of India now lost the hope about the existing political system, administration, other things, some people have emerged as a messiah for the Indian this thing in the name of Jan Lokpal Bill movement and other things. We find nowadays they are themselves are fighting. Yeah. So is there any hope for India in future, the emergence of civil society? What is your guidance for them?
See, Sambhavam Yuge Yuge means they don't come every day. So many of these come and go, but not all of them are Krishna Bhagavan. So don't confuse these smaller deities with Krishna Bhagavan. But I think that all this adds to the cleaning up process, and that's what is happening.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. I just would like to leave with a concluding thought. You see, I had a friend of mine who always says this in a lighter vein. You see, the first draft of the 12th five-year plan will be identical to the 12th draft of the first five-year plan. It always starts with problems, problems, problems. But you see, you have given us some hope through your speech, and I only wish yesterday the 15th Lok Sabha met for its last time. Probably at the end of the 20th Lok Sabha, hopefully all of them lasting its full 5 years, the 17th or the 18th five-year plan would start with a better India, always ready in the first draft. Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful speech.
I now request our registrar to hand over the memento to our esteemed guest. Request our Honorable Registrar to propose a word of thanks.
Our grateful pranams
at the lotus feet of Lord Almighty for having been so gracious to all of us in the successful conduct of the second day Daksh morning program. We are ever grateful to our revered Vice Chancellor for his kind direction, and especially to Professor SVS, who could make Daksh programs so powerful, really energetic, emulating, reverberating. We are beholden to Sri TSRS, former Cabinet Secretary, Government of India, who has mesmerized all of us with his scintillating talk coupled with his rich experience. Over the past 3 decades, I had the rarest opportunity of living with senior most IAS officers of this country who are known for dignity and integrity. They contributed to the welfare of this country. In the same way, I could see with TSR Subramanian, who had come on that particular line, is known for the dignity and integrity. These great officers, they followed only one rule in their life. They followed Swadharma. Su means Atma. The Dharma dictated by conscience. This is what Kautilya says. So, if we are able to have such kind of people in the helms of affairs, we are sure that the country is in the safest hands. Students of SASTRA should in fact follow the footprints of such great people who have been invited here, who have shared their values and also their experience with all of us, and make our country to feel proud, if not today, at least tomorrow. My special thanks to all the members of the organizing committee who has made the Daksh programs very interesting and also useful. Thank you. Let's all rise up for the national anthem and sing together.
Janaganamana Adinayaka Jayake Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarata Maratha Dravida Utkala Banga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Utchala Jalasi Saranga Tava Shubhaname Jage Tava Shubha Asisha Mage Gaye Tava Jaya Gata Janagana Mangala Dhayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He Jaya 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 He
Jai Hind. Chance many more questions are likely to come.